We are going to have our last presentation for this research paper session this morning. So Eugene, who has been attending to several of the HPC I/O workshop in the past, is going to present us his machine learning application to I/O characterization. So thanks Eugene, and we have like 25 minutes of presentation plus 5 minutes.
Okay. Hello everybody, can you hear me? Yes, no?
Yes, we can hear you.
Okay, thank you. Okay, hello, my name is Oeg Betken. I am a member of the research group at the German Climate Computing Center. In this work, as me and Julian, we investigate different approaches to identify jobs with similar I/O. We conducted a study on 1 million parallel jobs, and today I want to present some results. So here is the agenda of my presentation. I will start with monitoring data and give you an overview about capturing and transformation processes. I will introduce the clustering algorithms and show the main characteristics of them. And I also prepared a use case at the end of the presentation. So on the right, you can see the picture of our HPC Mistral. Okay, and some characteristics. Maybe the most important of them is that we have two file systems, two raster file systems. So this will be quite important for this presentation. So and I would like to start with some motivation why we are doing that. So, and one of the reasons for the project was high interest in what kinds of jobs are running daily on our system. So we are talking about 10,000 jobs a day. Surely understand that manual analysis of this number of jobs is not feasible. So, and among the jobs, there are many good jobs so that are using our machine efficiency. But these jobs are not of interest. What we want to find jobs that are wasting a lot of resources and can potentially degrade the file system performance. They are able to identify individual jobs. And now we exploit these jobs to find clusters of similar jobs. So the raw data is what we get from our monitoring system. It is four-dimensional. So we capture data from client nodes, from file systems, for 9 I/O metrics, and for the job runtime. So we capture in intervals of 5 seconds. So and the captured data has a domain. So, and units, for example, we can capture performance so in megabytes per second. So, and the value may be from 0 to 5 gigabytes per second. So, and this is too much so information for the analysis. So, and what we did, we converted the data to segmented data. So, it's still four-dimensional. So, we have still the same dimensions, but the increase the interval to 10 minutes. So, and the values just to 3 categories. So, 0, 1, and 4. So, and to get rid of the units. So, and so, 0 means that the performance during this time interval is not important. So, this is maybe, this performance cannot degrade the performance of the file system. It is not interesting to us. So, and 1 is high performance. So, and 4 is critical performance. Both are interesting. So, and we want to focus on this I/O intensive segment. On the right, you can see a picture. So, of a job representation. So, here you can see the 4 nodes. 3 metrics, so and 2 file systems that are different colors in the picture. So and here can we can easily see so the important sections so in the job, so I/O relevant sections, so or phases. So it makes the computation much more simple, I would say. So. What we did, so we captured 1 million parallel jobs, and converted them to Zygmunt data, but we had still too much data for the analysis. So, and we had to reduce the data further. So, and we do that in the pre-processing step. So, and then we need a good representation of the timeline. So, a suitable representation for simulations. We see them later. So, and similarity function so can compare two jobs. So, and can tell us so to which degree the jobs are similar. So, and in the clustering process, we use the similarity to group the jobs together that are similar. So, this is the, in short, this overview of the clustering process. So, let's look at the steps. So, the first thing we can do, we can aggregate all dimensions. So, and what we get a fixed size set of values. And we can use it, for example, for traditional machine learning. So, because they expect a fixed size of values. So, and if you want to keep the timeline representation, we keep the time dimension, we can aggregate other dimensions, for example, NAT or file system or metric dimensions. So, in this work, we use sum and mean functions for aggregation. Option. So, in the coding, as we already said, we are looking for a good representation of timeline data. I tried to give you examples for everything because this stuff is very complicated. So, and on the left side, you can see some definition. So, and on the right side, the examples. So, and what, and binarization is one option how we can change the presentation of timeline information. So, and what we do, we go segment by segment and assign to each segment a 9-bit number. So, and each bit in this number represents a metric. So, and if on any node, on any file system, so there's we find an activity. That means that M score is larger or equal to 1. So we set this bit to true. So and below we can see some examples how we can code each metric. For example, for MD538, we said we use the bit at position 1, and if it's active, we set it to true. And in the decimal representation, it's just 1. So and we can do that the same similar thing for other metrics. So and then we can encode all the metrics in just one number. So and on the right side, you can see an example. Here, for the first number is 1, it encodes MD538. The second number is 5, it encodes MD538 and metadata modification, so and so on. So, and we can also encode read code and read write, so in just one number. So, optionally, we can also aggregate all zero segments. As already said, the zero segments are something where no I/O happens, so and this section of the job is not of interest so to us. So another option for coding is hex quantization. So and here again we go from segment to segment, but this time for each metric. So, and we create sequences of numbers for each metric. So, and here we compute the mean M score for each metric and map it to 16 levels. So here, for example, if the mean M score is from 0 to 0.25, then it's map it to 0. Yeah. the next one, the next one, and so on. So, and the benefit of this representation is that we have a kind of performance value in the numbers. So, here, for example, we can see if the number is 9, that there was a high performance on nodes on file systems, and when it is 2, there was not so high. So this is, yeah, maybe quite important. And the next thing we can do optionally, so we can extract the phases. That means we extract the sequences of numbers that are larger than 0. Here, for example, from the MD5-8 matrix, we can extract the two sequences. One is the 2293, and the second one is 9111. So we can do a similar thing for MD3. So all others are empty. So the next similarity. Here we have three options. So we can use the Levenstein distance. And the Levenstein distance is just the number of operations required to convert one word into another. So on the right side, I have an example. So we can convert the word Saturday into Sunday just by three operations. We need to delete A and T characters and replace U, R, by N character. To get the both Sunday and the distance is 3. So, and we can do similar with coding. So, the next one is sliding window. It works also with different length coding. Here, in the example, we have two codings. One is 6 segments long, and another, the other one is 2. And what we do, we slide the shorter coding over the longer one and compute the similarity. So, and in the example below, if you shift the second coding 5 position to the right, we get the similarity to 22%. And our goal is to maximize similarity, so in sliding window approach. And the next similarity option is, if you have phases, we can combine phases with the highest similarity. So here in the example, I reused the example from above. Here's the highest similarity between two phases is when we shift the shorter coding price position to the right. So 1 and 1. They match exactly to 100%. So, and for the last phase, 811, they just have no coding, and the similarity is 0. So, and we need the final step. If you have the similarity, we use the similarity to cluster the jobs in groups. So. And if you have a data set of 6 size features, we can use machine learning. So general purpose machine learning, like agglomerative clustering from sklearn library from Python and so on. We try to do that. Indeed, but we encountered a problem, a scalability problem. We could cluster only 10,000 jobs. So it, we have 1 million jobs. It was kind of a problem. And we found a solution. To cluster the jobs, we used 10,000 jobs to we clustered 10,000 jobs with agglomerative clustering algorithm. So, and we could label 10,000 jobs, and then we used this data to train the decision tree. So that, and with this decision tree, that was really fast, we could cluster all other jobs. So, oh my God. But if you have a timeline that is of variable length, like codings after binarization of or hex quantization, so we need a special algorithm. So we invented a new one. This is a simplified density algorithm. This is very simple, very scalable. It has just one parameter, is similarity. It is a value between 0 and 1. So it has just one condition. So it adds a job to a cluster if the similarity between the cluster centroid is smaller than sim. So, and centroid becomes jobs that didn't find a cluster. So we investigated different clusters, clustering stacks. Here's the summary of them. So here on the button in the red box, you can see six different algorithms. So the first one is the machine learning. So we used the general purpose machine learning just to cluster the data. So then we have a bin full algorithm that reduces segmented data by some function. So it reduces node, file system, and metric, and use binarization to create coding and apply Levenstein similarity. Yeah, to compute the similarity between the jobs and use simplified density to cluster the jobs. So the bin aggregate zeros is very similar, but it does a zero aggregation. So and the hex lab it uses so the min function to reduce the node and file system dimensions and uses hex quantization to create the coding and uses again the Levenstein distance and simplified density to cluster the jobs. So hex native uses instead of Levenstein sliding window. So and PM quant, so it extracts phases from the hex quantization, that sliding window, and that's the phase matching. So it combines phases with high similarity together. So and then applies again simplified density algorithm. So and we conducted a number of experiments. So what we did is simple parameter exploration. So we tried to find the best sim value for clustering data. So and here in this picture you can see. So the first thing you miss the learning algorithms. So we had no success with machine learning. So we get many polluted clusters and no good results. So I just omitted the results. So and but for the other algorithms, we can see the effect of the sim value. We can see how many clusters are created. So if we vary the sim value, and here we can see some interesting things. So here above you can see the number of job types that are job types that are exact the same jobs, so exact the same colleagues. So. So and we counted the number of different codings and we found that there are slightly more than 106,000 different job types. And we tried the different algorithms. So and what we see has been with zero aggregation, as of when we increase the sim value, it goes towards this number of job types, which is the highest value. And the green line, it shows how many clusters we have that have more than one job. So, and we can see if you have a din value that is slightly larger than 0.7, the number of such clusters decreases. That means that we split the clusters that have two values in clusters that have only that have two jobs, that split in clusters that have only one job. And this is counterproductive. What you want some generalization. So, and this is a sign that an optimal value for the bin with zero aggregation is around 0.7. So, a similar thing we can observe for the bin all. So, that means without zero aggregation. So, for hexadecimal quantization with Levenstein, the pictures others see never achieve. This point where a simple gets counterproductive. So, and for hex left, we need a high sim value, so around 0.9. So, for hex native, this is the picture. We need a very, very high sim value, around 0.99, as you can see. So, and the implant has a good generalization capabilities. So, as you can see, that the number of clusters, this is the red line, it is so increasing very slowly. So, but here we can observe in the green line that the number of clusters is decreasing after 0.75. So, and a good value is probably somewhere in between. So, we conducted experiments. So, and I have some examples. So, first of all, machine learning. As already said, we have many polluted clusters. Here are examples. So in one cluster, we have we can find the following coding. Oh man. For example, 1 or 0 0 14 0. So they are quite different. So I can not see any logic behind that. So I would say the clustering is not so good. So the results are not so good. For binary representation, so here on the left you can see again the clustering stack. So this summary, this shows what we do. We do the summary of the data, we apply the binarization, we apply Levenstein distance and simplified density. And here's the one of the top 10 largest clusters. So, and here we can see something typical for the Levenstein distance. So it focuses on the zero segment. So the codings are quite similar, but we have a lot of segments that are not interesting to us. For that reason, we can apply a zero aggregation that removes this zero segments and focuses only on IO relevant parts. So, and this is what we can observe for this kind of aggregation. Wait a moment. Did you have a question or? Okay. the situation improves for hexadecimal quantization because we have larger coding and we have now the performance in coding. And for Hex Native, we apply a sliding window. That means that this Hex Native is a performance aware algorithm. It the clustering results are much better, but the job length in the cluster are always the same. So here, for example, we have the job length of 4 for 20,000 of jobs. So, and for PEM fund, we have a large amount of job length, as you can see in the picture, because we focus only on the phases. So, and here in the table below, you can see two columns, MD file, delete, MD mode. And you can see, we can find almost in each job, so very similar phases. And other columns are always zero. This is, so, and there are many, many of such jobs. So this is an observation summary. So I want to finish my talk with a use case. So how we, can we use that to find similar jobs? So, we can identify a job we, for example, with a high I/O load. So, and we can look in what cluster it is. So, here's an example for PM Quant. And in PM Quant, we indeed we find a similar codings like the problematic job. So, and this is the summary of my presentation. I want to skip it because I'm out of time. So thank you for your attention. So if you have a question, feel free to ask. Thank you.
Thanks a lot for your presentation. So I had a question related to the motivation of the work. So, that you have many jobs, so 1 million, I think it's a fairly large sample. And out of them, you want to extract, I will say, jobs which are not behaving correctly and which are consuming resources, wasted resources.
Yeah.
With your work, have you been able to identify some specific scientific field which are more prone to generate badly formed jobs?
We did it in our previous work. So we found a workflow, so which we can use to identify IO intensive jobs or problematic jobs. So, but we can identify individual jobs. And the problem was to find one job and all the similar jobs. And this is the subject of investigation of this work, I would say.
And my second question, so you did, I would say, something like a groundwork about applying machine learning to job characterization. Is it something that you think it's reasonable to have online, or it will always have to be something like a post-processing on a daily basis or even every week?
We can do that after we have monitoring data. That means after the job was executed. So, but just directly after that. So, because it works very fast, but we need to complete monitoring data. So, but it's almost online.
Okay. So, any other question? Otherwise, we will close this first session of on research paper and move to the second half of this morning. So another round of three presentations for 1.5 hours. So let's thank the speaker. Oh.